The United States didn't join the First World War until 1917, the third year of that conflict. They also didn't join the Second World War until 1941, again, the third year. The reason America dragged its heels was that many Americans did not want to intervene. I know, a bit of a shock. We can scarcely comprehend, in this day and age, a United States that doesn't head up the most massive military on Earth, literally spanning the globe. So what happened? I'm your host, David, and today we're going to be talking about how the United States went from being an isolationist nation to being the self-appointed policeman of the world. This is the Cold War. So we first need to go back to better understand the United States was already well poised to become a global empire. The nation itself was created from an independence revolt from the British Empire and a colony built on the land of many indigenous nations. The story of American expansion into these territories continues to this day. They called it manifest destiny. That's the belief that America was ordained to expand into ever more territory in the West, and in some cases, Central America, or depending how you look at it, Canada. By the late 19th century, the US considered becoming more of an actual empire, taking Spanish holdings like Puerto Rico and the Philippines, as well as Pacific islands such as Hawaii, from their indigenous governments. Under the presidency of Woodrow Wilson, the US began to more openly intervene abroad, including the First World War. So US imperialism is not without precedent. Okay, now where were we? Right, on May 7th, 1945, Germany surrendered to the Allied powers. The end of the war marked a significant turning point in the history of the world. Many powerful countries with vast colonial empires were devastated, but not the United States. The US had 12 million active military personnel, and over half of them were deployed abroad. There were 55 theaters and some 7.6 million service members who needed to come home after the war. This process is something called demobilization, which often gets shortened to demobbing. 2 days after Germany's surrender, the United States announced its plan for demobilization. The short form of the plan was to bring some people home and send the rest to fight in the Pacific theater. They announced a point system for enlisted personnel. It was called Advanced Service Rating Score. The score went up the longer you had been serving and also accounted for soldiers who were parents and even gave some bonus points for medal earners. Once you gained a certain number of points, 85 for men and 44 for women, you'd be eligible for demobilization. The military categorized some 3 million soldiers in Europe based on whether they'd remain to occupy Europe, get redeployed to the Pacific, reorganized and retrained before redeployment, or sent home. It led to massive chaos within the army structure. Manpower and training shortages were a significant concern, with a turnover rate for enlisted soldiers being roughly 1 in 5 per week. But President Truman was insistent that demobilization happen fast, and that these soldiers go home to their families as soon as possible. Camps of hundreds of thousands of American troops in France housed soldiers anxious to get home for months. Then, at long last, on September 2nd that same year, the Empire of Japan formally surrendered to the United States. There was now no excuse. The Second World War was firmly over. America now had millions of enlisted soldiers, and it was peacetime. The soldiers assumed this would be like every other time the US went to war. They'd quickly demobilize, and the army would shrink to just a bare-bones defense force. Until the next war, of course. The pressure from soldiers, their families, and the US Congress was overwhelming, and the slow demobilization plan was just not going to happen. Conscription rates were reduced to below the requirement for replacement. The points requirement to go home went down, and a bunch of naval ships were retrofitted to carry troops. Even with all this effort, it was a messy process. African American soldiers had a harder time going home due to strange ongoing segregation rules. Also, many soldiers were generally upset they couldn't get home fast enough. By December, the US had demobilized 1 million soldiers, but still, the political pressure to get these people home was massive. Delays caused protests, including an enormous demonstration by soldiers in Manila on Christmas of 1945, sparking protests around the world. It sped up demobilization on the condition they stopped protesting, threatening court martials for any who did. The pressure to demobilize left the military understaffed, especially once the draft ended in 1947, converting it to an all-volunteer army, a policy that had to be quickly turned back. Overall, between 1945 and 1947, the military shrank by a whopping 90%. At one point, there was even a plan for nuclear demobilization. The Akeson-Lilienthal report proposed other countries halt their development of atomic weapons, and in return, the US would dismantle its own nuclear program. As you can imagine, this proposal didn't survive long. At the end of the war, the United States and the Soviet Union remained as the only countries able to truly impose their influence over other states. A former multipolar world was now ruled by two superpowers, a first in world history. Bipolarity was now the order of the day. As the war was wrapping up, however, there was a thought that the Soviets and the Americans could coexist and even cooperate. Truman was reluctant to give them a hard time in the immediate aftermath of the war, but the tone began to change as the Soviets used the moment to consolidate power in Eastern Europe, propping up authoritarian communist regimes allied to them. Stalin's five-year plan in 1946, which announced a continued building of the Red Army, also raised tensions. Come to think of it, we may have done a few videos on this. Within a year of the end of the war, it was clear a new struggle's fault lines were taking shape. Not to say there wasn't pushback against a harder line against the Soviets. People like President Franklin Roosevelt's former Vice President Henry Wallace, as well as FDR's wife Eleanor Roosevelt, pressured Truman to cooperate with the Soviets. In March 1946, former British Prime Minister Winston Churchill gave his infamous Iron Curtain speech, urging the US to head up an anti-Soviet alliance in the wake of a closing world. I won't even try a Churchill impression because, well, I like you all too much, but the text of the memorable speech goes like this. From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste on the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere, and all are subject, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow. In new flashpoints around the globe, the US and United Nations pressured Soviet troops to leave occupied Iran or back off from claims over the Dardanelles and Bosphorus Straits in Turkey. Tensions rose in Germany's occupied zones, a story you can watch in this video on the Berlin Airlift. American diplomat George F. Kennan wrote the infamous Long Telegram. It outlined the Soviets' aims and claimed that to stop them from their global conquest plans, they had to practice a policy of containment wherever communism appeared. There'd be no compromise, no peace. Neither the US nor Soviet Union would be safe as long as the other existed. Truman was proposing a new direction for the United States. A country anxious to see the war over and without much interest in getting involved in other conflicts abroad had to be sold a plan to radically change their foreign policy outlook. It now needed a permanent wartime mobilization. Truman first wanted to make a case for giving loans to aid Greece and Turkey to prevent Soviet influence growing and to maintain Greece's monarchy. But more on that in other videos on this channel. No, really, we'll get there. We promise. Truman requested a whopping $400 million from Congress. Making the case, he outlined a foreign policy position now called by historians the Truman Doctrine. He wanted the US to be out there supporting free people who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures. Isolationists who didn't understand why it was America's job to get involved in a Greek civil war, as well as those on the left who wanted to cooperate more with Moscow, opposed Truman. But he did get bipartisan support for his aid package. This vote was the moment that Congress broke with precedent and the United States became a different country. It would no longer be an isolationist state, but instead made the world's business its business. Still, with the monopoly on nuclear weapons, Truman didn't think he needed to invest much in the US military. it had shrunk to a much smaller level than it had been in 1945, but still remained much more substantial than pre-war levels. In 1949, the USSR tested its first nuclear weapon. The National Security Council, in the wake of this surprise event, drafted NSC 68, an order which called for massive inflation in military spending, more money to their allies, and an aggressive pose in the Cold War. Truman dismissed it until the outbreak of the Korean War, which changed his mind in a big way. The US had to be ready for land wars, wherever communism might pop up. Still, Truman did see the necessity to fight communism outside of military spending. In 1947, Congress passed the National Security Act of 1947. It merged the Department of the Navy and War into what would become the Department of Defense. He also created the Air Force, Central Intelligence Agency, and the National Security Agency, the latter two being intelligence organizations dedicated to espionage and counter-espionage at home and abroad, respectively. So America was now one of two global empires. They were ready to intercede wherever they saw fit to counter Soviet aggression, or at least what they saw as Soviet aggression. In effect, it was a fundamentally transformed country compared to a generation previous. It was the beginning of both the Cold War for the United States and the America of today. We hope you've enjoyed today's topic, and to make sure you don't miss future episodes, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and to press the bell button. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/thecoldwartv. We rely on our patrons to create these videos, so consider supporting us via www.patreon.com/thecoldwar. This is the Cold War Channel, and don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it becomes heated.